Good day, everybody. Connor McIver, Remax's Paris 911 team. People ask where we get the content, where we get the ideas for the various radio shows we do at housingradio.com. And it's simple. It comes directly from the experiences of either our clients or other real estate clients out there. I do a lot of reading via my RSS feed engine on Feedly, which gives me all the information I need with regard to real estate, what's going on. Plus, of course, being a local market expert here in Santa Clarita Valley, SEMI, greater Los Angeles areas, does not hurt. So that, coupled with the experiences, and we're going to talk about some of those today, that coupled with those experiences is what gives me the content for all the radio shows we've done. You can see many, many episodes, housingradio.com. We also have a YouTube channel, SCV Moves. You can check that out as well. As you can probably tell via the audio in the background, I am on the move this morning, heading to appointments. And thank you for tuning in. All right, here's something interesting that you might not know of real estate, especially if you are a real estate buyer or seller. I do believe this is useful information, and information that isn't explained very well by, I would say, 95% of most agents. It used to be that real estate was handled a little bit more, it was more complex. There were more moving parts. It wasn't so automated as it is today. This is what I mean. Technology has advanced so much that you don't realistically need the assistance of a real estate agent to find a house to buy. You can just go online, or as they say in that movie, on the line. But you can go online and you can search for real estate ad nauseum all day long. And for the most part, you're probably going to be somewhere between 80-85% accurate. Because, and the reason why it's not 100%, some of the websites, some of the big boys on the block, they are actually gaming you. So that's how they work. That's how they pay for themselves. Basically, if they can give some cool-looking property, looks like it's a super awesome deal. By the way, this isn't new. Remember the real estate magazines that were out there at one point? There was nobody enforcing them whether or not an agent put in a fake listing that maybe a picture of a house in a depressed economy but a really nice house, saying that it was located in a different city to get a person to call their toll-free number and enter an extension, thereby that being a number trap and so on. That was the real estate magazines for the most part. There were real listings in there. But on the other side, there were trick listings to get you to call, so now this agent could attempt to convert you. So there's nothing new under the sun. These large syndication sites are doing the same sort of thing, so that's why you're not at 100% accuracy with them, because they have to monetize themselves some way. And on the other side of that, real estate agents are paying a lot of money to get your information so they can use that to contact you and convert you and make you their client. My voice told everyone that reaches out to us, because most people are finding us via referral, or they're also finding us via Google Organic. That's the search that we're not paying for. It's just our content is so good on a local level with the radio show and the YouTube channel, all the other things we put into play. You know, do some Googling, say, you know, who is Connor McIver? And then you can make decisions as to whether or not you're going to utilize Connor McIver or you're going to move on to someone else. It's important, the content your agent is creating. Now, this is a real-world problem in real estate, as we were starting to discuss. And what happens is you're searching online, you find a property, your agent verifies that that property is, yes, indeed active. And that's kind of a precursor. That's before your agent has the ball, right? This is kind of at the beginning when you're first starting to contemplate looking for real estate. First best step, you might not know this, you want to sit down with this consummate real estate professional and go over how it all works. And part of the presentation that we give our buyers has to do with identifying properties and making offers, and when that property actually is the buyer's. When does that happen? Back in the day, like I said, real estate used to be a little bit more complicated, so when an offer was written, typically it was presented to all parties. So, yes, real estate moved a little bit slower, not as many transactions able to be closed during the year, but I think that respect and the time invested was a lot more important instead of just relying on a computer system to let you know and a text message from your agent stating, oh, yeah, it's done, congratulations, so on and so forth. Back then, we actually used to sit down with everybody at a table. You had the buyers, you had the sellers, you had the seller's agent, you had the buyer's agent, and we would all sit down. A lot of times, the lender would be there as well, and we would work it out. And back then, property prices weren't nearly as expensive as they are today. So hence the commissions reducing in the real estate realm in some markets. We see that also. So we would all sit down and we would come to an agreement. Maybe the buyer offered $3,000 less. Maybe the seller's not willing to take that. So it would all be negotiated at the table. And it was kind of cool because it was all finished. So at that moment, it was known whether or not that buyer was actually the buyer and actually was the accepted offer for this particular piece of real estate. That's when it was known, when everybody got up and left after that 30-minute or hour-long meeting. Well, this is somewhat pre-facts, so you can kind of, I'll date myself a little bit. Faxes really weren't trusted very much, so it wasn't really something that was utilized. And then, of course, faxes became very trusted, and then we had these certificates. Remember, the faxes used to spit out some kind of a completion certificate stating that the fax actually went through. But that in of itself was not enforceable. Well, whatever. We still use that piece of paper as if it was straight out of the Bible, right? We would use it like it was canon. We would say, oh, no, I sent you that fax. I don't know if you remember those days, but that's how that was. Moving into the new world, it's not that way. We have confirmation of acceptance. We have deposits that aren't really real money during the offering process. You do have verification of funds, which is something that's submitted. So that would show the deposit and down payment in some account somewhere. But when you are having that offer written on a particular piece of real estate, the buyer really doesn't know. And sellers embrace this. The buyers don't know whether or not they got the property until that executed contract is signed and the confirmation of acceptance is rendered by the actual seller of that property. This is after negotiation, of course. So I can't tell you how many times I have been given the news by another agent, oh yes, your buyer's the one. They're going to be the ones chosen. Don't you worry. And, you know, being in the job since 1998, I've learned, don't call that shot until you have in writing. Because then the next phone call is, hey, Connor, you know, God, I feel so bad. So sorry to do this for you. The seller's just received another offer, and it's $20,000 more than your offer from your buyer. So they want to talk about that. And that's horrible. So now I go back to my buyers after I've already told them, if I'm doing it incorrectly, after told, oh yeah, you guys have the offer, don't worry about it, I trust this agent. Now all of a sudden I have to go back and say, well, you know, I'm so sorry I made that phone call, a little premature. And that's real estate 101, folks. A little premature, and I shouldn't have called. I should have waited until I had the executed document. That's not good for a buyer. That's uncomfortable for all parties and something that is worth addressing on today's show. So we have the executed contract. We have a confirmation of acceptance. We have a deal. Without those items, verbal or not, an agent could be saying all day long, oh yes, you're the one, we're going to select you. But then right at 0 hour, that last offer is submitted. Now, of course, there are time delays, right? What is the recourse for a buyer that gets told by their agent verbally that another agent told them that they're the ones that have been accepted when, in fact, the scenario changes? You might be able to get a judge to listen to it. Probably not. You might be able to get an attorney to potentially listen to it and maybe fire off a letter. But at the end of the day, the seller's going to be able to sell the house to whomever they want, of course, putting aside gender and sex and religion and age, any of their protected classes, of course, putting all that aside. At the end of the day, they're going to be able to do what they want. Plus, it wasn't fulfilled. The executed contract wasn't received. On the other side of the coin, when it comes to acceptance and offers submitted, we talked about the scenario with an agent telling you, oh, yes, it's all done. We've had it work the other way as well, where, well, we don't know what the seller's going to do. They do have multiple offers, and we've had agents actually send over a confirmation of acceptance prior to those other offers being negotiated, and we've had to enforce that. Because now we have a confirmation of acceptance, an executed contract, and for whatever reason, the way that it played out is the agent sent that prematurely, not really knowing what they're doing. So that's something to be aware of if, in fact, you get in the scenario. But at that point, your agent should be able to stand there and not try to, you know, represent you. If an agent's going to make a rookie mistake like that and send out the confirmation of acceptance when they're still working on or maybe responding or having multiple offers together, and this has happened as well, there's really nothing you can do as a home buyer because your agent's already told you, already sent you these offers. So the seller to come back and try to pull the deal, it's that one there will end up in front of a judge if the seller is being very strict. This is something the agent needs to explain to the sellers as well of the world, how that process works. You agree to this, and you're locked in as a seller. Buyers, of course, have a lot of contingencies and reasons to cancel if, in fact, things go awry within whatever the time frame is that was allowed by contract. Sellers, not so much. Sellers get a chance to respond to what the buyers will ask them to do, potentially repairs, modification of price, if there's some kind of a credit that's supposed to be given. Maybe a buyer goes into the house and sees some electrical issues when the home inspector looks at it. The buyer can go to the seller and say, listen, you know, Jack, we would want this brought up to code because it's a safety reason. Ultimately, the seller can refuse. So depending on the type of market, if it's a huge seller's market, which it is, less than 400 units of inventory, then more than likely, the seller's probably not going to step up to the plate, just depending on how much activity they had on the home and the advice they're getting from the agent. And then Mr. or Mrs. Buyer, that's your time to pull out if, in fact, you get upset about it. But the other thing, had a couple clients, wonderful, going into new housing. We went in there to represent them, and there were some choices to be made about what type of home and so on. I look at everything from a business perspective. In the future, what is going to be able to have the most value added as far as the property that they're purchasing? Is it something that's kind of unusual as far as the track goes? And we actually found something. Number one, it's a single story. Then number two, it's got additional square footage and additional bedroom, which isn't normal because the lot itself has to be larger to accommodate that particular property width-wise. I was jazzed and excited, and I shared that with him. I said, I appreciate you liking that three bedroom, but as far as future goes, looking for resale and looking for rentability or whatever it is you're going to do with it, this property is pinging a 10 ring on every single advantage that it's showing us, then this is the one personally that I would select. There you go. Expert advice, I think it does help, and in fact, they did decide to go with that one, and I know that is going to be an excellent choice, just because a few reasons, and I'll give you the top one. Very rarely, at least in the Santa Clarita Valley, you're not going to find a whole lot of single-story residences that are newer. They're going to be older, back in the 60s, 70s. Nothing wrong with those homes, but some people like the look of something that's been built from the 2000s to 2015s. If we're talking new construction, folks, very few. So this was one that we were blessed to get for our clients. I'm Connor McIver. Thank you so much for tuning in. This is some of the things you might not know about real estate. Interesting and for you. HousingRadio.com. Please share when you're ready to start searching for real estate. SCVNest.com and, of course, HousingRadio as well. Com will also give you that information. I'm Connor McIver. Be safe. You can search on our systems and be protected. They're all SSL encrypted. In addition to that, none of your personal or private information ever goes anywhere except to me, Connor T. McIver. Have a great day. We will talk to you soon. Weekend coming up. We're Thursday, so be safe with that. And we're almost to Christmas. I won't tease you with how many dates because it's pretty easy to figure out today. Have a great day. We'll talk to you soon.